Okay, so for this next part, we're going to copy the original fire. I'm going to paste this over the top of the existing fire here. And the reason we're doing this is so we can make it look like part of the fire is in front of the text, and part of it is obviously behind it. But on the second one, on this fire, we're going to actually call this like fire foreground. This will be fire reflection. And this is like the fire background layer. Make it a little bit easier to keep track of. All right, so on the fire foreground, grab the pen tool, and we're just gonna kind of mask out a certain area. So I'm going to choose this part of the ground. I kind of want to keep those. And then I'm going to grab probably most of this O and kind of maybe cut through the E here. Come down here, do something kind of like that. I think that will work. That looks okay. And I'm going to toggle my mask visibility off so I can see this edge better. And that looks hideous. So let's click the F key and increase our mask feathering to, like, I don't know, 60 is good. It seems to do a pretty good job. Maybe 40. So now it looks like some of the fire is actually in front of our text. Now, the biggest problem here, though, is that it doesn't really look like this fire is actually influencing the front side of this. So let's add some more point lights. I'm going to go back to my two view setup and change this to my secondary view. Rotate this around. And then on the point light, let's duplicate that. Let me move one of these further down, and this does need to be in front of the text. And maybe to see this a little bit more clearly, you can turn off your fire. I kind of want to keep it on just so I can see where it looks like this light makes sense to put. Something around there would probably be okay. Whoops, make sure you grab the right layer. It is a little bit too yellow, so we can change that in our settings here. Just double click on the light. Maybe just make that a little bit more red, go to a more reddish hue, more saturated red, and that might help. You could also increase the intensity, but we don't want to have values that are like really noticeably clipped. 150 might be okay. Might need to go back and change that later. But then I can make a copy of this, and I can move one over here. I think that is a little bit too hot. Let's pull that back to just 100%. And one other thing, let's actually increase our bit depth. So this is at 8 right now. I'm going to hold the Alt key down and just click 16. You're not going to notice any changes yet, but when we start adding some blending modes here in a minute, we may actually see a difference. And the difference between screening and adding is that adding allows your values to exceed your 8-bit color range. So if you've ever used add and you get some really odd results, it's probably because those values are being clamped. So really they could go higher, but since there's only 256 values for red, green, and blue, there's only like 16.7 something million colors or something, which sounds like a lot, but really when you start going to higher bit depths, you do actually realize that there is a lot more range that's available if you start using 16-bit and 32-bit and so on and so forth. So I'm gonna go ahead and just change that to 16 right now. Probably save that for another video trying to explain that. Let's move this over. Something around there would work pretty well. That kind of illuminates our letters just a bit. Maybe pull this up. We can have multiple lights here. It doesn't really matter. And the next part I'm going to show you is how we can add a simple expression to get these values to kind of move around so it looks like it's kind of flickering. Because we've already got the flickering going on in the background because it's just using the fire. And since the fire is blurred, it kind of makes it look like it's changing. But the light at the front, it doesn't really look like it's changing. So let's go back to our front view here. And we can just start with our main point light. And I think this would be easier if I soloed the light and soloed the ground here. So we can see that going on. And then if we click the A key twice, we can open up our light options. And we want to make an expression for intensity. So Alt click on the stopwatch, and we're going to use the wiggle expression. So it's wiggle followed by how many times a second you want it to change, like 5, comma, and then how many, or how, whatever unit you're using, how many of those do you want to change it when it's varying? So let's do like 35 or something, and then close your parentheses and click the numpad enter key. And if we play this, and let me just shorten my work end to clean the end key. I render this pretty quickly. You can notice it's flickering very slightly, which looks kind of cool. It makes it look like it is an actual fire that is flickering, and so is the light source as well, because the fire is the light source. So something like that is kind of cool. And we can copy that effect. Let's copy this, and we can put this on everything. You can even change the values a little bit. So it's the A key. Change this. You could do like, I want this to vary from 45, or maybe only go 4 times a second or something. You can just play around with these values. So I'm going to go ahead and change all of these. All right, so I've added an expression to all of my point lights here. It's okay. We could probably increase the intensity of that just a little bit, the intensity of the flickering, not the intensity of the light, because already we're running into areas that are exceeding our 8-bit range. So we really should go back and change these and fix these just by lowering these lights, like this one, point light number 3. Go back in, just maybe make that like 75%. That's going to lower these values. This one right here, we could do the same thing. This, I think, is causing it's 100%. And the higher these values, we can go and check what those are, especially if we're in a 32-bit. It's kind of easier to check. So if we change this to 32-bit, go down and then hover our mouse open over these pixels, and an info will display what the red, green, and blue and alpha is. So we can see anything that's over 1 is exceeding our 8-bit range, which is what our monitors are probably set to. I mean, unless you have like a super expensive fancy monitor that does probably like 10-bit or something, but these values are way higher than that. So this is like 2, which is really, really high. So what we're gonna have to do later is probably go back in and just try to color correct these so that they're not clipping. However, we might not even see it, so let's not waste too much time doing that yet. Let's just go ahead and keep going with it, and then if it becomes a problem, we'll fix it later. Okay, I'm gonna unsolo these and then have everything turned back on. Okay, so this is beginning to, you know, look kind of interesting. There are quite a few things that we can do, and there's a certain things like here where it doesn't look particularly good because our fire is kind of soft, yet our text is really, really sharp. So let's fix that right now. Let's go into our element text, and I'm going to close down the element effect so we can actually have more room in our effects controls area. Go back to another effect, and we're going to go and type in camera lens blur. Camera lens blur. Okay, so this is a really good effect for mimicking like defocus on a camera. And unless your camera is on a tripod and is really has really, really high megapixels, it's never going to be really, really sharp. So let's go and just at least add 1 to this and see what that looks like. We could probably even go like 1.5 on that radius. It's going to soften these edges down a little bit. I think it looks okay. But we're going to have to also copy this and paste it on our edge mat as well. Otherwise, that's going to be really sharp. So that looks a little bit better. Let's kind of scrub through here and see what we have. I think this will work. Okay, so let's make some particles. Let's make some embers. I'm gonna close all of these lights here and just kind of tidy up my scene a little bit. Okay, close that. All right, so let's make a new solid. I'm going to call this fire or embers. And I'm going to move this just above everything. All right, so we're going to do CC particle world, CC particle world. All right, so when we select this layer here, we can see that there is, in fact, a grid that's associated with our focal length of our camera. And we can actually put this in 3D, but it's going to, it could cause some issues, and I really don't want to have to worry about it. I'm not going to move the camera out that far. It's not really going to matter. Let's open up our producer and our physics, and then go to particles. And just to go back on that, if, let's say, later on you wanted to play around with some in-camera depth of field, this would need to be a 3D layer. Otherwise, the After Effects camera is not going to recognize this as being further away in your Z position, so it's not going to blur it appropriately. I'm actually just going to do a blur over the entire thing, like the entire thing was completely out of focus, and then it focuses in. I'm not really doing a depth of field effect, so I'm not going to bother with putting this in 3D. But if you do want to do the depth of field effect, then you would need this to be in 3D and then positioned appropriately. Okay, so first thing on this, let's go to our floor, open that up, and then our floor position, let's just increase that. So it needs to look like it's actually on the floor, and that's a little bit too high. Let's go like 0.03. That looks reasonable, 0.02 maybe. No, I think that looks pretty good. Okay, it kind of looks like it's there. Focal length looks a little bit off, actually, but, you know, it's close enough. We're actually, this is going to be particles, so it doesn't really matter. And then we can increase our radius, our X radius. Pull that out a little bit. And then our Y, we can actually reduce that. We don't need that much range. Kind of just kind of on the floor there. That'd be all right. And I'm going to then solo this layer just so we can have a look at it better. And then let's click the... And then just click space so we can see. All right, so that's not really what we want, okay? Let's change the animation to cone axis. And then let's, right now, let's set the gravity to 0. It's going to go straight up. And then on our particle type, let's do a faded sphere. Birth color, we can do something a little bit more fiery looking, a little bit more orange. Now that would be all right. And then on our birth size, let's do like 0.05. And then our death size, 0. It's going to be pretty small. Well, let's increase that just a little bit. Let's do like 0.1 for our birth size. Okay. They're still going way too fast. So let's go to the velocity and change that to like 0.2. Looks all right. But now they're dying before they get high enough, so let's increase our longevity to like 4. All of them are always alive, so let's do like 3. Something like this will probably work pretty well. Okay, other things that we can do, we can change our direction axis, so this will only be for certain types of modes, so cone axis is one of these modes, and we can just move our X axis so it kind of matches the direction of our fire. So if we remember, this actually goes from left to right, kind of match that same motion. And that looks okay. And then we can also increase our volume shade like 50%. That kind of gives some variation in the color, which looks kind of good. Okay, so there's probably other tutorials that show like really, really good embers. I'm not going to spend a ton of time on this. And honestly, I think like Trap Code Particular actually has a lot better particles than what After Effects can do. But we can improve this a little bit. Let's add some glow to it, for instance. Add some glow. We can increase our glow radius. And then let's drop down our intensity to like 0.5 or like 0.25 perhaps. We can do 0.25, has a little bit of a glow, and then we can add a curves on it, so we can maybe get a little brighter hotspot in it. Pull this up, and then pull this down just a tad, might help. I think these are actually too big now, so let's go on our birth size and do like halfway, so 0.75, might actually give us a better result. Motion blur would also help, so let's add motion blur to our comp and add motion blur to our layer. Very subtle, not really moving fast enough to have a lot of motion blur. We could increase our velocity maybe just a little bit, so we add a little bit more of that blur, which does help. One thing though is we probably want to actually make this glow. We probably want this on the bottom. Glows should always be the last thing that you do, or anything that would things like camera lens blur, that should always be on the bottom. And remember that it's the complete opposite of how the layer stack works, so effects on the bottom are actually the topmost effect. But this really doesn't give us a lot of variation or kind of roughness, but there is an effect called roughen edges. So let's do roughen edges and place this in between your curves and your glow. And when you first apply it, everything is going to go like really, really dark because it's kind of like clamping in that matte. So on the border, if you just reduce that and do like 4, like 3 or something, or 2 more of these, kind of look a little bit look a little bit more like embers, just a little, maybe not exactly, but you can also increase the complexity of this to give it a little bit more roughness. Now let's way too high, like 4 or something. Let's see how this looks. Unsolo this. Let's have a look at it. So these are really, really, really sharp, but we can add a little bit of a lens blur effect to this as well. Let me just turn this on with the fire background. Let's have a look and see what this looks like. They're also starting too late in the shot. So grab the embers, grab the actual layer, and pull it back. So those particles are already well on their way at the very beginning of the shot. So they're never going to start slowly because that looks really weird. I think also we've made our particles too small now after doing those roughened edges. Let's go back up to our start size and our birth size and put that back to 0.1. It might actually help us. Okay, I'm going to set my mode to screen. And I'm also going to add a camera lens blur effect. And this is going to be the topmost layer. So let's just do a value of around 2 to match what we had done before. And now it's no longer sharp, and they kind of match a little bit. We could also add on our curve. We could also go back to our curves. We could see what actually removing that does. Let's actually take this curves, and I'm going to pull this down at the bottom. And right before the camera lens blur effect. And pull that in, and I just want to drop down these values. I'm going to reset it. I'm going to pull this down just a little bit, so a little bit deeper colors, slightly more contrast. I think that actually helps us. Pull down some of the darks. Okay, I'm kind of pleased with that. I think that works. You can also go into your birth rate and just increase that. So there's more embers. Okay, I'm pretty pleased with that. So let's unsolo these. But for this layer, let's place this behind the text. Let's go right before the ground, or right in front of the fire. We can do that there. And then we can copy that, and then we can place another one that's above our text, something like this. But on this one, to make it look like it's a little bit different, let's offset this a little bit, move that away. And then let's change the position on our producer. On the producer, we want to change the position Z, actually have this come closer to the camera. And if we look at both of these, you can see that some are larger, some are smaller. And on the ones that are closer to the foreground, we actually reduce the birth rate. So there's going to be fewer of those particles. And you could play around with maybe that volume shade percentage. Increase that a little bit so there's a little bit more variation closer to the camera. We just want to make it look like these particles are in 3D space. Something like that might actually work. You could spend more time on your particles. These are not the best things I've ever done in my life, but I kind of thought it would look cool with some embers. So also, some embers should be probably darker than other embers. So on your death color, you could even make some of these much darker.